and perhaps hewn from their pragmatic Italian coach and by some of their own stars' immersion in the cutthroat world of European football. They are both also joint the tournament's top goal scorers, along with South Korea. But perhaps significantly, Australia has the best defence. Could that be the key to success here this evening? Or will Japan's greater invention hold sway? There is the trophy. And Japan certainly have the edge and experience in going for that silverware. This is their fourth final, as opposed to Australia's first. And they have won the previous three. Success tonight would make them the most successful nation ever, moving them ahead of Saudi Arabia and Iran, both of whom also have won three titles. Australia, of course, the new kids on the block, are looking to make it a unique double, with the women's team having won the Asian title last year. It's a rivalry that is modern, but no less intense for that. But today is the biggest meeting of all for Australia and Japan, with the title of Asian champions up for grabs. Now, before we have the national anthems, the players are going to be welcomed by some very important persons on the sideline, led by the Asian Football Confederation President, Mr. Mohammed bin Hammam. And he's flanked by Jinji Ogura, the Japanese Football Association President, Frank Lowy, the Football Federation of Australia President, the President of the Qatar FA, and by no means least, the Crown Prince of Qatar, who is representing the Emir here today. Mohammed bin Hammam, who of course is a Qatari by birth, and Frank Lowy behind him, who after the presentation of the trophy after the game will take the flag as the leader of the country which will host the next Asian Cup in 4 years' time, that of course being Australia. Special day for these players. About to play off for the title of being regional champion. And now that the presentation ceremony is over, it's time for the two national anthems. Wherever in the world you are watching, a warm welcome to Doha for the Asian Cup final. And what a fascinating battle this promises to be. The new generation of Japan versus the golden generation of Australia. Japan going for a record fourth title. Australia looking for their first in only their second attempt. Here's the team news. Australia unchanged, so Brett Emerton remains on the bench. In truth, it would have surely been difficult for Holger Osik to replace anyone after the drubbing of Uzbekistan. Four of the starting 11 made their name in the A-League. Goalkeeper Mark Schwarzer breaks the appearance record tonight, his 88th cap, taking it past Alex Tobin, who is here to watch the man take his record. The referee is the top official in the region, Uzbekistan's Ravshan Ermatov. Asian referee of the year for 3 years in a row now. His assistants Rasilov Abdul Kamidulo and Rafael Ilyasov, also both of Uzbekistan. The two captains hoping to hold the trophy tonight, Lucas Neal of Australia and Makoto Hasebe of Japan. And Japan make two changes. Shinji Kagawa, of course, is out with injury. So Jungo Fujimoto, who's just signed for Nagoya Grampus, comes into midfield. Maya Yoshida also returns after suspension to the centre of defence. So Daiki Iwamasa drops back down to the bench. Holger Osik has won a continental title before with Canada back in 2000. And of course knows Japanese football only too well after guiding Urawa to Asian club success 4 years ago. And as for Alberto Zaccheroni, he's looking for his first trophy since leading AC Milan to the Italian Scudetto back in 1999. He's been in the job just 6 months. The only man missing for Australia on the bench is of course Jason Kalina, who has flown home early. And no Kagawa or Daisuke Matsui on the bench for Japan. So we're all set in Doha for the Asian Cup final. The clash of the titans ranked 1 and 2 in the region. A full house to watch it, perfect conditions. Sepp Blatter and Michel Platini in the stands as well. It promises to be a mouth-watering contest, but who will be good enough to lift the silverware? Tonight, the previous 10 finals have produced just 16 goals, and the team scoring first has always gone on to lift the trophy, Andy Harbour.
Good evening, Simon. What a terrific night here in Doha. As Japan look to be champions of Asia for a fourth time, Australia looking for their maiden victory in this tournament. I think it's the ideal final. I think whatever happens tonight, the best three teams in the competition will finish 1-2-3.
Both teams have looked pretty relaxed in the build-up to this final. As Lucas Neal remarked, if you can't get excited and look forward to these games, then you never can. Here's Harry Kuehl with an early sighter. Scored at that end of the stadium, of course, against Uzbekistan in the semi-finals. Could be a key man tonight.
Well, I think there's going to be 22 key men out there. It's really difficult to split these teams in total. Of course, everyone's talking about the technical superiority and the mobility of Japan, and that's to be acknowledged, but the difference isn't as stark as a lot of people are making out, in my opinion.
Kale to Holman. This is a chance for Australia. Matt McKay! Oh, and he sliced it wide.
That attack is a good case in point. Australia with a real spring in their heels early. They'll have enjoyed the extra day's rest compared to that which led them into the semi-final against Uzbekistan. Matt McKay needs to fix his finishing. There's no question about that. He had a couple of great chances against Iraq. It's a common story in the A-League as well. It's really the only thing missing from his game. He's had a stunning tournament. That would have been a stunning start for the Socceroos.
Talking of technical superiority, as you were, Andy, 51 cameras at the stadium tonight. More than the World Cup final last year, as Kuehl is penalised for handball. It's being broadcast to a worldwide audience of over 100 million.
Well, football in Asia is growing. I think it'll grow faster with Australia's involvement. It'll continue to grow with Japan and South Korea making the great strides they are, setting the bench high, making the countries, the big countries like China, chase them, Saudi Arabia. The future is Asia, as the AFC boasts. And Australia very grateful to be part of it.
Come Japan being roared on by big numbers in the stands. They've probably got the numerical superiority in the terraces.
And just to finish off that point about the technical difference between the teams, Simon, the other stereotype which has been rolled out the last few days in preparation for this final is that Australia has a significant physical edge over Japan. Well, they may have a physical edge, but it's not going to be huge. I mean, Japan have worked really hard over the last 10, 15 years of addressing that very fact. They're no mugs. They can stand toe-to-toe as well as anyone.
Uchida, quick feet. Keisuke Honda, solid challenge from Jedinak. Now they spread it wide to the dangerous Nagatomo. He's been pinpointed by many as being one of the key players this evening. Endo floats it in. Hunter's got away from his man, and Schwarzer drops on the ball. Danger for Australia there.
Sorry, Simon. Keisuke Honda also appealing for a penalty. Seemed to have an Australian arm across him. This is the danger man, one of them. There's plenty, as we said before. There's Carl Valeri just getting in the way. Probably a good decision from the referee. But I'm one of those many who think Yuto Nagatomo is a key. He's had a fantastic tournament, really and truly. And if Australia can bottle up Japan's left-hand side, they'll go a long way to achieving their goal here this evening. The other battle, the other thing to watch for this game before it really gets going is the role of Brett Holman, Simon. And his ability to nip in from the blind side and dispossess unwary opponents has been a real highlight. has been the launching pad for many Australian counter-attacks.
Certainly did that to great effect against Uzbekistan in the semi. This is Cahill, marginally offsides, but marginal is enough. Good decision,
seems to be.
Another look at Keisuke Honda's header. He was off balance. There was some contact with Carl Valeri. Not enough for the spot kick to be awarded. And this is Nagatomo. Little triangle involving Endo and Honda. Space for Okazaki, but a heavy first touch allowed Jedinak to regain ground. There's a real sense of anticipation around the Khalifa Stadium. Fans have been pouring in for the last 2 or 3 hours. Game a complete sellout, as you'd expect for a major final. I suppose even seasoned professionals, such as a lot of these players are, bound to have a few nerves before such a big game in front of such a big audience.
A lot of talk in the lead up to the game, how big this football match is for Australia in the context of its football development, and the same of Japan. And of course, World Cup is the big prize, but the closer it got to game day, and is indeed arriving at the stadium, I'm sure it's the same for the players. The magnitude of this occasion not lost on anyone.
Lucas Neal actually saying, Andy, that he felt this game was bigger than reaching the last 16 of the World Cup. There's Michel Platini, sat with the Crown Prince of Qatar, President of UEFA, of course. Platini, Sepp Blatter on the right of screen, President of FIFA. Maybe not for much longer if Mohammed bin Hammam has his way. Rumours he will challenge for the top job. It's these two teams challenging for Asia's top trophy at the moment as Uchida trying to tee up Fujimoto. Luke Wilkshire will put it up towards halfway, and Harry Kuehl, who's had such a fantastic tournament. Can't get around the outside of Kono.
That's going to be a good contest, that one. Both have hit a similar top speed in the tournament, Simon. We've been fed the statistics from the heat maps, etc., which have been appearing on people's screens for 31 previous football matches, and that data's starting to be crunched. Really interesting and very even foot race between Connor and Harry Kuehl emerging.
This is Honda. Square for Endo. Back to Honda, who is regarded by many as being perhaps the best player in Asia. A few on show today who might challenge that mantle. Ryuichi Maeda pushing it into the path of Nagatomo. This will centre it away by Okunovsky and subsequently by Cahill. And then Kuehl and Cahill unable to combine. Japan, the marginal favourites perhaps in this final, back in possession. Keisuke Honda, little 1-2 with Fujimoto. Can Schwarzer prevent the corner?
There's big trouble here. Schwarzer's out of the goal.
And I think he might have picked up a knock as well, Mark Schwarzer. Mm-hmm. Just dug his studs in the turf there, the veteran keeper, as he attempted to clear that ball. Just watch this. Oof. Oh, it's the knee. Ouch.
Ball not going out, and Schwarzer writhing in pain at that point. He's still not fully recovered. Fair enough from that point on. Nagatomo looking to pierce the empty net, the empty goal of Australia. Schwarzer now back to his feet. That's a nasty one. Good desperation from the keeper. Japan settling in. 9 minutes gone. They'll work the ball patiently. They'll look to get the ball in the centre of their attacking third, try to draw Australia's defenders in, and then by definition free up the spaces out wide for the likes of Nagatomo down the left, and to a lesser extent Atsuto Uchida on the right hand side. I say to a lesser extent because he's had a much quieter tournament.
Now let's see how this Knee holds up, looks to be okay, Mark Schwarzer. It was a nasty one though. Knee really dug into the turf. Not the start Mark Schwarzer would have wanted, I'm sure, on the occasion of his 88th cap. What a great game to break the Australian record in. Break for Nagatomo. Neil and Valeri tidying up. A bit of a slice off the boots of Schwarzer and then a foul by Maeda. Or rather Okazaki, my mistake.
Yeah, Shinji Okazaki, because of the injury to Shinji Kagawa, has moved from right to left. He's had a great tournament himself in number 9. Very dangerous as a right winger, right midfielder. We'll see how he goes on the left-hand side. Fujimoto gets the nod to take on David Carney.
Tim Cale just jumping a little too early, landing on Endo. Yasuhito Endo, one of the fulcrums of the Japanese midfields. Only the fourth Japanese player to win over 100 caps. It's his 106 tonight. Here he is on the ball, the 2009 Asian Player of the Year. Actually missed the 2004 final through suspension. Got sent off against Bahrain in the semi. That was the last time Japan won the trophy. Australia, of course, never before passed the quarterfinals. Although this is just their second appearance in the Asian Cup. Memories of great recent battles of the past, Andy, have been stirred by the build-up to this game. World Cup 2006, the last Asian Cup, which Japan won on penalties in the quarterfinals. As Luke Wiltshire finds some space here on the right, can he pick out Cale or perhaps Kuehl? In the event, it's neither.
There's not a lot between the two teams since that day in Kaiserslautern, which so set things going for football in Australia. Key part of a very important sequence of events from qualifying to that opening 2006 World Cup match. 3-1 that day.
Neil up towards Cahill, who's always a danger. Will it drop for Holman? It's clear behind. Australia will have a corner.
A good little passage of play for Australia. Timmy Cahill's aerial prowess attracting both central defenders, and Brett Holman there just trying to read the rebound.
And I'll tell you what, Andy, if Japan don't know about Tim Cahill's aerial threats, then they should do, because he scored 4 times against them in those 2 games that we're mentioning, World Cup 06. And then, of course, one of the World Cup qualifiers a couple of years back.
Indeed, and the only time Australia's lost against Japan in recent memory was on penalties 4 years ago at the Asian Cup. Very close between 2 Asian heavyweights. Australia, the new kids on the block.
Mackay's corner. Well, it's gone straight out of play, which is a major disappointment for the Socceroos. Perhaps a bit of a nervous start for Matt Mackay. Huge game for the only player in this Australian starting 11 actually playing his football in the domestic A-League. He's had a super tournament. And he's had the one really decent half chance so far of this final. Unless you count Honda's at the other end. But my, how he's grown in stature. He's only small, Matt Mackay, but he's had a big tournament, Andy.
Well, I think it's a testament to the coach, who's not been afraid to bring players in who might have the reputation of others. He's backed them, given them the confidence to believe in themselves. It wasn't that long ago that Matt Mackay and his ilk were perceived to be part of the problem in Australian football. Now they're looked at as a key part of the solution, which is exactly the way it should be. Holger Rosick, in a very short space of time, has done a very good job. Both coaches, relatively new to their tasks, and Gordon Zaccaroni of Japan as well.
Now, Australia will be a threat at set pieces, no question about that. Ognanovsky and Neil have ventured forwards. Dealt with by Maeda. Now the counter is on for Japan. Shinji Okazaki. Honda and Fujimoto wait in the box, but he's just crowded out eventually by Okunovsky and Wiltshire, at least temporarily. Yeah, that was the right idea by Yasuhito Endo. Just spotted a bit of space for Shinji Okazaki.
That's what Australia's all about, its current guys. As soon as they were able to relieve pressure with that pass from Endo, just going through to Schwarzer. Schwarzer immediately looking, whilst Japan had committed players forward to get the ball to the vacant parts of the field. It was Harry Kuehl who was outnumbered, but it's just a little bit of a sign of where Australia's at the moment. A warning to Japan that if they're going to push forward, they've got to watch their defence as well.
Clever back heel by Mackay, and it goes, and Valeri and Cahill were going for it, and neither was able to get the touch. But super combination play between Mackay and Holman on the right set this chance up for Australia.
Very good, and as dangerous as Japan's left side has been in attack, Australia have had some good space down that part of the field already.
Well, Mille Jedinak is going to be grateful to his central midfield partner there, Carl Valeri, even though he's picked up a yellow card for the late challenge, because it was Jedinak's mistake from the throw-in that allowed Japan to launch that little mini break there. So the first yellow card of the final goes to Carl Valeri, probably rightly so.
Yeah, clear foul. Referee right to award the yellow card. It does make it a very early one for Carl Valeri, just 16 minutes gone. He's been excellent for the Socceroos as well. Jason Kalina limping off at halftime in the match against South Korea. Valeri and Jedinak have done a mighty job to make sure that the absence of Kalina is lessened.
Now we're fully aware of the threat Japan posed from set pieces. Honda and Endo are both specialists of the art. This is a long way out though. Will this be Keisuke Honda's stock in trade, the Cristiano Ronaldo type free kick which bends and swerves? I think that's what he was attempting to do, but the touch off the wall made it rather easier for Mark Schwarzer.
I think he's more dangerous from that sort of range, the deflection notwithstanding. The way he does like to thrash the ball, so Keisuke Honda. Set pieces is part of the difficulty he poses for Australia, but it's the way he drifts off that front line in front of Hasebe and Endo, the two anchoring midfielders. He's a real danger man. Honda, beautiful pass with the ball. He and Honda in sync, he and Endo in sync, rather, spells danger for the green and gold.
Carney gets a bit lucky, good ball in. Kuehl couldn't quite get enough on it. Wiltshire will retrieve, Holman in support. And Okazaki covering well for Nagatomo. Jedinak. Back it goes to captain Lucas Neal. 0-0 in the Asian Cup final in Doha. Sasha Ognjenovski continuing his meteoric rise. They look for Harry Kuehl early. Kono kept pace with the Galatasaray striker. Happy to put it behind.
Kuehl appreciates the work. It's nice from Mille Jedinak. Right in behind Kono, who himself has had a wonderful tournament. Harry Kuehl positioned himself beautifully, putting the pressure on his marker. He heads the ball for a corner. Taken this time by David Carney, not Matt Mackay.
But again, it will be the outswinger with the left boots. Oh. Cahill leads. It's there. Is it for Australia? No, it's clear. Just underneath the crossbar. We said Australia are going to pose a danger from these set pieces. Carney swings it in again. Cahill leads. Kuehl on the turn. Can't make contact. And just for a moment, I thought it was going to dip over Kawashima. But Australia denied as Japan scrambled really well.
Well, Timmy Cahill again making his presence felt. Kawashima just scrambling and swatting somewhat, effectively so in the end. Harry Kuehl with a deflection, not quite enough of a deflection. A nervous moment for Japan.
Well, credit to the goalkeeper. he'd been positioned anywhere else, that was going in off Harry Kuehl. Forgive my excitement for a moment, I thought it had. It's that sort of a night in Doha. Kuehl, clever dummy. Holman. He didn't quite connect properly with the delivery towards Matt McKay.
The wavelength to set. Touch from Holman, ultimately poor one, but the lead up was really good. Japan under pressure.
Australia starting to play. Neil, is there a body check there by Yoshida? Referee says no. It's lovely work by Fujimoto to release Yoshida. Honda left it too short for Endo. Good snaffling again by Holman.
That's the point, that's the point. David Carney probably left things a bit short by pressurising Fujimoto. Holman read the situation, came in from the right flank and pressurised.
That's not a good ball though by Holman.
It was open too for Luke Wiltshire on the right hand side. That was the target.
...20 minutes gone, Andy, and you sense that both sides have just begun to cast off the nerves.
You certainly do get that sense. They've both had good moments. Australia, two really good sights of goal. They won't be able to afford to waste too many more.
Neil getting a bit lucky there. Carney. Goes long for Cahill. Kono wins the aerial battle. Jedinak is then fouled. One or two of the Australians perhaps suggesting that Shinji Okazaki should join Carl Valeri in the referee's notebook.
No, I don't think so. Foul's enough. He went for the ball.
Early delivery. Looking for Cahill. And he wins the header, as he so often does.
This time it was over the taller Maya Yoshida.
He just has that ability, Andy, doesn't he, to hang in the air.
The consistency is amazing. But interesting for Australia's attack is that Japan now are in a couple of different minds. They know Tim Cahill is a reliable outlet in the penalty area for the aerial assault. But they've also witnessed, experienced firsthand Australia playing the ball on the carpet. And Japan now are primed to have to defend two different forms of attack.
Nagatomo, there's a bit of room for manoeuvre. Good, strong, sturdy challenge by Neil. Had to be two. Cahill chests it down. Valeri feeding McKay. Bit of a nothing ball from David Carney. Through the first half, no goals. It's a mistake though by Holman. Fujimoto, Maeda, in for Nagatomo, now infield for Endo. Again, good scrambling by Australia. They try and release Harry Kuehl. We've got a whack there from Kono, and referee has spotted it, and that'll be a free kick for the Socceroos.
Already looming. It's a key battle. Kono probably within his rights to go for the ball there. Harry Kuehl trying to control the ball, just backing into the Japanese defender. Perhaps fortunate to have received the free kick there. Nevertheless, the Socceroos will take it. There'll be plenty of give and take, one feels, in those sorts of situations through the football match.
Kawashima wants a wall of two. Fujimoto coming across to make it three. Luke Wiltshire looks as though he might just be preparing to dink this up in the air for the likes of Jedinak or Ognjanovski or Cahill. Delivery just a little bit too shallow from the Dinamo Moscow defender. Carl Valeri taking no chances. Oh, Hasebe. Endo. Out for Uchida. Just too strong for Shinji Okazaki. Japan have struggled to find a regular goal scorer in recent years. That's a tangle of legs, but Kewell committed the infringement. Looks as though Shinji Okazaki is certainly one of the solutions, along with Ryoichi Maeda. Both have got goals at this tournament, six between them. Here's the captain, Hasebe. Endo out for Uchida. Hangs one up, it's a dangerous one. And Honda got in between Neil and Ognanovsky, but couldn't get the ball.
And both Neil and Ognanovsky very comfortable in dealing with this. Day before that, Matt McKay and David Carney. Very good communication. Who was to pressurise Uchida? By the time the ball gets into the danger area, Australia's two central defenders have got things sorted out.
Goals for Mili Jedinak at this tournament. That's good skill initially to take him through two defenders, but Hasebe was backing up. Neil wins out against Maeda. Now it's with Carl Valeri. Scored his first international goal against Uzbekistan, the semi-final. I'm sure we'll have made all Canberrans very proud with that strike.
Dad Walter, of course, famous footballer in his own right in Australia. Holland with another sloppy touch. His last three possessions have gone to Japan. Needs to improve that part of his game. Get back to what he's been doing very well up till this final match.
McKay looking for the run of Kewell, who knew exactly where Timmy Cahill was running towards.
However, read it beautifully. Then a defender.
They're developing a good partnership, those two, though, Andy. Kewell and Cahill. Kewell playing the Mark Viduka role, as it's commonly known in Australia. Cahill just off him. Neil looking to spread the play for Wiltshire. We'll go for the early cross again. Kewell! Well, it was another decent sight of goal.
It was excellent play from Australia. Luke Wilshere, not for the first time, down deep. This is the best start to a match we've seen from one of Australia's best in this tournament. Kewell strong in the challenge, couldn't control the header downwards. But there are questions being asked of Australia down Japan's left side. And it's an astute piece of work from Holger Osik. Everyone knows the threat of Nagatomo going forward, but he's got a new partner in front of him. Shinji Kagawa is back in Japan. Shinji Okazaki normally plays on the right, has done in this tournament at least. And now Nagatomo and Okazaki have to find themselves singing from the same sheet, as it were. Quick smart, because Luke Wilshere has found enormous territory down that right-hand side.
And Okazaki, Andy, of course, is normally a central striker as well. Although he has played a fair bit on the flanks. So a bit of an unfamiliar role for him this evening. Ognanovsky. Bit of a lull. Only in play, but also around the stadium. This packed house inside the Khalifa Stadium. It's well won back by Holman. He's really impressed doing that at this Asian Cup. Just ferreting away for possession, as Honda has done here for Japan. And feeds it into the path of Okazaki. Goes the goal, took a deflection. Well, they're claiming handball, Japan, but I don't think it could have been intentional by Sasha Ognanovsky, unless the replay proves different. And instead it's Harry Kewell. And now Wiltshire for Australia. Jedinak with the switch. To make good progress. Oh, and a mistake by Nagatomo. Can Harry Kewell make them pay, Japan? Just misjudged the flight of the ball there, Nagatomo. This is Jedinak who will drive it. Slightly awkward bounce for Kawashima, but he feels it no problem.
Well, apart from Australia, when they swing the ball down the right-hand side to Luke Wiltshire, they're making really good ground when, with the ball at their feet, they're carrying the ball out of defence into midfield, bypassing the Japanese strikers. When they get the occasion, drawing the Japanese midfielders and then bypassing them with the dribble. Japan not really rearranging as they need to when that penetration has been made with ball at foot.
Nagatomo. Keisuke Honda. Sebe. And now Endo. It was well marshalled by Okunovsky. Not giving them too much room, are they, Neil and Okunovsky?
No, they're not, and then they get to find his range. Australia's formation very compact, as it must remain.
Mackay picking up the scraps for Australia. Now Cahill. David Carney wasn't advanced enough on the left for him to choose that option, so instead it's Neil. Cahill, here's a chance for Harry Kewell, and he's hit the side netting. Another opportunity goes begging for the green and gold.
The more you call it like that, Simon, the more danger it's going to be for Australia, because the chances aren't going to keep coming. Kewell again finding himself in front of goal, the ball taking him into a very, very narrow angle onto his less favoured right foot. He makes good contact. But the coverage probably sufficient. The end, another good setup from Tim Cahill. Another good chance for Australia.
Now Uchida to Fujimoto. Harry Kewell with three goals at this tournament. Not so far tonight. They've fashioned some good chances, Australia. Carney down the line, Cahill. Commits the foul. Well, possession relatively even. Australia just on top.
It's not a statistic I was expecting after half an hour, I'm not ashamed to say. Expecting Japan to dominate the ball and to do so for large periods in Australia's half, but Australia doing a very good job at forcing Japan into their own half. And squeezing the space behind once that's done.
This is Kono, one of the elder statesmen in this Japanese outfit. Average age of the squad is around 25. Australia, by contrast, probably one of the oldest teams in the tournament. Sebe. Uchida. Now Endo looking to probe the Australian defence. There's a bit of room here for Nagatomo. Draws Wiltshire out wide. Cuts inside for Honda. Now Endo. And back again. There's no real penetration as yet for Japan. Maybe now from Maeda. Mackay holds him up. Uchida. Just gave its gift wrap, really, to David Carney. No real trouble for Australia.
Well, that was superb collective defending from Australia. The decisions were good from individuals. The communication, excellent. Japan, no way through. In the end, characteristic error from a fine player. Suta Uchida. Just outsmarting himself there.
He's a fine player, Suta Uchida. for quite a few Japanese players who plies his trade in the German Bundesliga with Schalke. Very much the Japanese breeding grounds in the modern day. Okazaki linking with Nagatomo. Good two-footed player, Nagatomo, even though he plays on the left. Good strength by Neil. He's had a terrific tournament, the Australian captain. Jedinak looking for Kuehl.
Hey, don't fucking find your flag up!
Foot was high by Harry Kuehl.
Just backing in as well there, that might have been the first thing the assistant referee saw. Representation of Asian players in the leagues of Western Europe. They realise they need that component for the national team to achieve its ultimate goal, which is to win a World Cup.
Well, they're going about it pretty well. 10 of this squad play in Europe. Of course, by contrast, 16 of Australia's old continent. So maybe that's one of the reasons why they are playing off for the silverware here today. It's not the entire reason, of course. J-League is pretty strong. The A-League coming up on the rails too. That's a lovely ball from Honda. Here's a chance for Japan. And Maeda has screwed his shot wide of the target. But what a ball through from Keisuke Honda.
Beautiful. And it's roles reversed. It's Endo on the end of it who sets up Maeda. But it's the Endo and Honda duet that Australia have to watch. Honda made a similar pass to Nagatomo, who set up Maeda for the equalising goal in the semi-final against South Korea. He's got a beautiful eye for the killer pass, and he's got the touch to go with it. Surviving Australia's repeated efforts on goal. It's the Socceroos who breathe easy after a great chance for Ryuichi Maeda.
Man of the match in the semi-final was Keisuke Honda. He, like many of the Japanese players, have really grown into this. Started off very slowly, didn't they, Andy? They were very lucky to avoid defeat on match day one of the group stage against Jordan. Gradually, slowly but surely, they've found their feet and their rhythm.
They had two very difficult group matches to get things underway. The player sent off. Major Kawashima's main goal, actually, in the match against Syria.
Chested down beautifully by Cale, but just behind Brett Holman. Unfortunate for Australia.
It was really only the third group game against the Saudis where they had an easy 90 minutes, knocked away five goals. Otherwise, they've had to fight tooth and nail for everything, literally everything.
Sign of a good side, though, that doesn't lose, even under the severest of pressures.
Indeed. No question about that. They're strong mentally, good physically, artistic technically. Deserved finalists.
Clear foul by Mackay. Well, he wants to have a word with Brett Holman here, referee. And he's issued a yellow card.
Second Aussie to go in the book.
Well, unless my eyes were deceiving me, that was Matt Mackay who committed that foul.
Said something. I'm not going to question your eyesight, those things.
Plenty have. Uchida. Well cut out that by Matt McKay because Honda was free and behind him. Shade over 5 minutes to go before the break. It has been a fascinating arm wrestle between Asia's two finest teams. This is Carney. Kuehl again plays the hold-up role superbly. Coleman. Cahill in space. And I've got numbers back now. McKay, Carney arriving on the overlap. And they get the delivery right. Looks to be a bit close to the keeper and he let it go. Kawashima and Cahill, although he was arriving like an express train, was a little bit late at the platform.
Well, I tell you what, Eiji Kawashima did back himself and he's let this go. And as he's looked, he's, oh my goodness, it's Tim Cahill. And he's just run out of real estate as Cahill. There's a good attack from Australia. Nice overlap down the left-hand side. Matt McKay having another good performance. David Carney with the instinct to get forward. It's an instinct that's been rekindled by Holger Rosick. Australian players now with the imprimatur of their coach to leave their defensive position and support the attack. It's why Australia has made the final. And it's why they've got a good chance, still with 41 minutes gone, of winning the final.
Good to see a fair few Australians in the crowd. Some of them have jumped on a plane on a whim, just here for the weekend to see whether their team can lift the trophy. They've got some defending to do here. Jungo Fujimoto on the ball. Now Hasebe. Endo. That's well anticipated by Ognjanovski. Really have looked pretty solid, Neil Ognjanovski. One of the reasons why Socceroos have conceded just one goal in this tournament thus far.
Yeah, it's excellent defending again, and the quick release to Harry Kuehl. He backed himself to beat Maya Yoshida. Again, with some open territory. It is the case, based on what's happened in the preceding matches, that Harry Kuehl will beat Maya Yoshida in a foot race. Just the angle and the sideline work to the Japanese defenders. Benefit there.
Uchida down the line. Good touch from Hasebe. Now Fujimoto. Valeri was quick back to cover and Carney stepped across. Enjoying a decent period of possession here, though, as we approach half-time. Okazaki, 1-2 with Honda. Now Nagatomo. Again, they try and work those little triangles. Nagatomo's in behind. Maeda couldn't get there ahead of Ognjanovski, who, again, is positioned perfectly. Australia under a bit of pressure here. That's alleviated by Harry Kuehl, defending from the front. Now is the counter-attack on. Kuehl. Tackle by Yoshida, Fujimoto. Nobody there for Japan. Neil into the channel looking for the run of Holman. He'll get there ahead of Nagatomo. He's kept it in play just. Is that a foul? Linesman didn't flag. Holman carries on. Support from Wiltshire. Left-footed ball in. Matt McKay goes for it. Drifts harmlessly away and behind for a goal kick.
Well, the manner in which Matt McKay drifted into the attacking zone then to link up with Harry Kuehl, Tim Cahill, make that third player a real advantage. He was outstanding at this in the semi-final. Makoto Hasebe had to track him, drop into the defence line to run with the Australian midfielder. The piece of intuitive attacking play from the captain of Brisbane Roar. Another good delivery from Luke Wilshere, back to his best, Australia number 8.
Hey, such a vital piece of that attacking armoury, isn't he, for Australia, Luke Wiltshire. He gets his delivery spot on. Australia can cause problems as Japan can too, of course, with Keisuke Honda. Again, just not quite the right connection. It'll drop here for Okazaki, though. And now Fujimoto. Square for Honda. Now Yasuhito Endo. Into injury time at the end of the first half. Just the 1 minute they'll be. Ball stayed in play, just about. This is Yoshida. Challenge there by Holman. Kuehl sniffing for scraps. Kono gets it back to his goalkeeper. This might just be about the final action of an intriguing first half, Andy Harper.
Yeah, it's been nip and tuck, hasn't it? Japan have had their moments. Australia have had the better chances, or certainly more chances. Be disappointed they haven't capitalised.
So Ravshan Ermatov blows for half-time, and we're no closer to knowing who will be the Asian Cup winner for 2011. At the break in Doha, it's Australia 0, Japan 0. Well, as you said, Andy, both teams had their moments in the first half, but there's probably no doubt that Australia had the better opportunities. Japan coming home with a bit of a wet sail towards the end of the first half. Good periods of possession. And Keisuke Honda started to look dangerous.
Well, he's a danger man. Endo's a danger man. Nagatomo has been quiet by his standards in this first half. And for that, you have to pay credit to Australia. Luke Wiltshire has been getting forward very frequently. And it's just putting that element of doubt in the left fullback for Japan. But the chances have gone for Australia. They'll be very buoyed by the way at times they've been able to outplay Japan, and their defending has been excellent. Really, it's well organised, they're well drilled, they know exactly where each other is, and that's why they've been able to keep Japan at bay. Very good first half.
Well, perhaps it took a little while to warm up this game. There's a few nerves on both teams, really. Australia perhaps quicker to settle, Andy, and Matt Mackay with a fantastic opening in the opening 2 minutes.
Just lost his head at the moment. It was most needed, you reckon. He's had a good half. Matt Mackay on the back of an excellent quarter and semi-final. And that needs to feel the full force of the law, that one. The fact that he sliced it, to me, shows that he just lost concentration. From the set piece again, Australia are going to consistently be dangerous there. Good work from Kawashima in the end. As Harry Kuehl with that second effort after Tim Cale had won the first challenge. Was goal bound. The keeper backing himself and saving his team. He's had to be on his mettle because Australia have had plenty of sights on goal. Luke Wiltshire in good form again. Really, Nagatomo doesn't know how, along with Shinji Okazaki, to deal with Luke Wiltshire at the moment. Of course, on top of that, you've got Brett Holman breaking from the wide position into general space and causing trouble. Keisuke Honda is the danger man. A series of beautiful passes have put Japan in good positions. He's the man who needs to be watched. And whilst watching him, Australia have to watch the runners who are looking to profit from his passing. You called it correctly, Simon. It was ball to hand. It has to be intentional for the referee to give it a penalty. It couldn't be considered that way. And Japan doing their own good scrambling in defence. When one defender's beaten, he turns and he sees two or three others retreating and helping. And defensively, both teams will be reasonably happy with what they've dished up.
Well, Yanaku scored two goals at this tournament, of course. One from that similar sort of range. This was another decent opening for Greener Gold. Harry Kuehl, perhaps not on his favoured foot hitting the side netting.
And Tim Carr wanting the return there with the setup. For Kuehl, just wanting his teammate to square the ball. It's a big ask. Maybe Kuehl can kill the ball, turn out and set up a second chance, but can't really complain about the instinct. And this is the moment of the match, as far as I'm concerned. Just pure artistry from Kosuke Honda. Ryuichi Mada, after being put in front of goal by Yasuhito Endo, couldn't deliver. It's a great chance, wasted.
Yeah, it's a super player, Kosuke Honda. Always. One that Australia going to have to watch. There's what they're playing for, the Asian Cup trophy, but it is goalless at the interval between the teams ranked 1 and 2 in Asia. 12 shots on target in that first period. Australia having the lion's share of that. And as you can see, the possession stats, which did favour Australia after about half an hour, eventually tilted back into the favour of Japan as the first half drew to a close. So it's a stalemate at the interval. The goals may come. Well, they have to come at some stage, even if it goes to penalties. But we'll be back for the second half very shortly.
Please get stage for 15 minutes for your safety.
Zach's pack that wins the day here in Doha. We're not really any closer to finding out. It's been a fascinating first period here at the Khalifa Stadium. But it remains goalless between Australia and Japan. Plenty of ebb and flow about the first 45. Both sets of players not even daring to look at the trophy they want to take back home this evening. Who's had the easier team talk, you think, Andy Harper, Alberto Zaccheroni or Holger Osik?
Well, I think Holger Osik has probably had the easier team talk. I think the expectation is on Japan to have prized Australia's defence over more times than they have. And certainly the players would have that expectation of themselves, and the coach would be funneling into that expectation. Holger Osik, Socceroos, I thought, defended as a collective really, really well. And the plan is to bring Japan on to them, get Japan to commit numbers forward, and then hit them on the counter-attack. The counter-attack hasn't quite been as smooth as they'd have liked, but he'll be very happy with the number of chances they did create. Just disappointed, as he was at half-time against South Korea, that they didn't take one of those great chances.
No changes by either side at the interval. Japan have done their huddle, and we're set for go for the second half here in Doha. Asian Cup trophy, the prize for the winners, and a place in the 2013 Confederations Cup as well, of course. Who will it be? Australia or Japan? So Australia get the ball back rolling again. Kicking from left to right in this second period. Lucas Neal immediately launching a long bomb, which is knocked down well by Cahill. Harry Kuehl sidesteps the defender. And then across came Hasebe, the captain, really playing a captain's role. What a smart piece of work that was initially by Tim Cahill and then subsequently Harry Kuehl. Beautiful combination.
But a good plan from Australia early. Now they've got to get their wits about them, quick, smart and defend, because Japan are building.
Uchida, away by Okunovsky, miscontrolled by Hasebe. Wilkes are out of harm's way. Now Holman, Cahill, Yedinak. Was he taken late there by Hasebe? He was. Well, that was clearly a foul by Hasebe, but earlier on, credit to the Japanese skipper. He saw that his team was in serious trouble, and he got back and made a brilliant block to deny Harry Kuehl.
He's had an excellent tournament, Hasebe. Harry Kuehl had stopped and propped and turned nicely, and the goal was beckoning until Hasebe slid in. It's a brilliant piece of anticipation.
David Carney to chip this one in, hang it up for Cahill. Okunovsky will retrieve. Wilkshire did well to get a cross in there from an awkward angle. Neal picks out Holman. Okunovsky along the line for Mackay again. Look this time for Harry Kuehl, who nods it down looking for Cahill. Wiltshire, he'll try again.
Yeah.
Goes Tim Cahill, but he was leaning on the defender. Free kick.
The frustration for Tim Cahill there, I think, shared by a lot of people who've played centre forward, is that he didn't penalise for getting the good position and getting it first. It was Connor who was backing into him. Good case for play on there. No surprise that the decision maker, the defender, usually does. Situations.
Turned forward by Valeri again. Kuehl and Cahill. Interchange. Holman. Wilkes are arriving in support now. It's an awkward one for the game. It's certainly claiming that it did. It certainly struck the woodwork. But the linesman was perfectly positioned. The referee, I think, had a glance towards the touchline. But there was no signal that the ball had crossed the line. Another one of those contentious moments where nobody was quite sure whether it was a goal or not.
I'll tell you what, there was a very nervous man with his finger on the pyrotechnics button at that point, because that was a close call. Hines' initial reaction was no goal. And there was no goal. He just was bouncing, begging to be punched home by someone in green and gold. There was a cross gone wrong, in truth, from Luke Wilshere. I think Harry Kuehl's appealing for a handball. I don't think he could have been appealing at that point for the ball crossing the line, which it quite clearly didn't. But a very good start to the second half by Australia. Very positive, looking to get the ball forward early. Wilshere again picking up from where he left off in that first half, with another raid down the right-hand side. Just 4 minutes in, he's already made two raids down Australia's right flank.
Well, Eiji Kawashima looked like a tennis player who was desperately striving to make a lob there, didn't he? Like has happened sometimes in tennis, the ball did not go into the net.
Very interesting. Alberto Zaccheroni has Iwamasa stripped on the sideline for Japan.
He's going to have to wait a moment. Clearly offside, though. Jungo Fujimoto.
The aerial threat from Australia is proving too much. And it's Fujimoto to come off. Iwamasa on. There will be a rearrangement. Iwamasa, I would imagine, will go into the centre of defence.
Have a look at that moment. Miss hip cross, really, from Luke Wilshere. The Australian bench were convinced. Why wouldn't they be? Some of the Aussie fans, too. Well, maybe not quite so sure. So, Daiki Iwamasa on for his eighth cap. The defender from
He hasn't come on yet. There's been some hold-up for some reason.
My apologies.
Put his tracksuit back on yet.
Well, he certainly wants to come on. Maybe Fujimoto doesn't want to come off.
I think they've just had a quick word with Yasuki Kono as well. Another player who's struggling for Japan. This is a fascinating little twist, early stage of second half.
Meantime, free kick for Australia, delivered by Wilshere. Holman just dropped off and found some space. He tries for goal, but he's got it all wrong. I think that was a shot from Holman. Unless you're going to tell me differently, Andy.
No, certainly not. But it's been one of those halves for Brett, one of those games for Brett Holman. Again, he's taken up a beautiful position. And he received the ball nicely, invited himself on towards Japan's goal, but the shot was poor. So many good things in the first half, but then some cheap turnovers to take the gloss off his performance and give Japan an advantage. It's been a strange game for Holman so far, yet still he looms as a real danger man for Australia.
And still the question mark around this substitution, is it going to happen or not? There's all sorts of debate going on between bench and players. Eventually, Iwamasa has gone and sat back down. Very strange. Maybe they thought there was an injury. Mackay. First time on the half volley. Cahill leaps. Might drop here for Kuehl. And he's blazed it over the top. He's had a few half chances today, Harry Kuehl.
This is a procession, procession of headers won by Tim Cahill. It's no wonder Alberto Zaccheroni is wearing the soles of his shoes out in that technical area.
Holger Rosic having his head in his hands.
Another one bites the dust for the Aussies. Count that as a great chance. Nevertheless, it was good possession. Inside virtually Japan's 6 yard box, and that is remarkably rare to see Yasuhito Endo do something like he's just done.
Kai and Phil for Valeri. Now back with Carney. Yeah. Delivered from that deep angle now. Was there a body check there from Kono? Cahill certainly thought so.
There was a penalty awarded in the semi-final, Japan-Korea, for something similar. Kono has blocked a run. The point of deliberation for the referee is, where was the ball? Was it within playing distance? There's no doubt he's obstructed the runner, Tim Cahill. The referee didn't see it as an illegal block. Tim Cahill begs to differ.
So the stalemate remains. Australia 0, Japan 0. Extra time and penalties, of course, are a possibility if we stay the same. Well, in fact, more than a possibility. It's a downright certainty. Yoshida.
Good pressure on Milo Jedinek. Excellent pressure. He just waited, allowed Honda the touch, and then squeezed him, anticipating the second. No free kick, despite the pleas of SK Honda. Here comes Naoki Iwamasa. He's put the fourth official again. Really gets some game time now.
Mackay got that one wrong. Get an act from Honda again, going toe-to-toe. This time there will be a foul. Now Japan do want to make the change.
So it's the same change. Fujimoto to come off. He's left the field on the far side. Masa now on. Job will be to bottle up Tim Cahill, I'd imagine. He's been able to do that so far. So Kono's come on to left fullback. Nagatomo has gone into the Shinji Kagawa position with Okazaki into the centre. But that will change Okazaki and Honda, I'd imagine. Nagatomo now playing that left attacking midfield role.
Is that a good switch?
That's going to spice things up a bit. Yeah, well, he doesn't now have to rely so much on defending or worry about defending and the work Luke Wiltshire is doing up there. He'll still have to keep a vigil on Luke Wiltshire. He's got a bit more freedom now to hog that touchline and attack Australia. The real motivation for the substitution is the Harry Kuehl, Tim Cahill aerial prowess. Yoshida and Connor just have not been able to come to terms with it. Bruno Zaccheroni suggesting sooner rather than later something's going to fall for one of these Australian support players.
It's a touch off Carl Valeri.
So that change for Japan also means another area of opportunity for Australia. Why not a midfielder switch to central defence? There he goes at left fullback.
To Nagatomo, the small advance roll, back for Kono. Endo. Honda, that's well robbed by Miller Jedinak. Kuehl, Mackay bursting through the midfield. Wiltshire is gaining ground on the right. Four arriving into the penalty box for Australia. Deep it goes, looking for Jedinak. And that's well fielded by Eiji Kawashima. But a really swift counter-attack by Australia.
And just have a look at this as a discussion point, Simon. It's Mile Jedinek challenging the cross, but it was Mile Jedinek who made the steal in centre field. And this is advantage Australia. You know, it's understated just quite how good these guys are athletically, aerobically. Mackay, Holman, Jedinek, Valeri. Certainly Valeri's topping the charts for the number of repeated sprints. It's enormous capacity. It's enormous output. And that was underlined by that work from Mile Jedinek. A really smart piece of theft to get rid of KSK Honda. And then he continued his run to challenge for the cross. It was great play. It's a good building block for Australia.
Just on Carl Valeri, his average running stats throughout the entire tournament. Puts him in the top 10 in this Asian Cup of all players. The average is, I think, over 11 kilometres a game.
And I guess, you know, whilst we're crunching the numbers, the more telling stat, he's ranked two in this Asian Cup for the average number of sprints per match. And that's our central midfielder, underlining the amount of work he does, covering, winning tackles, passing and supporting. It's brilliant stuff. Really brilliant effort from Carl Valeri. He's got plenty of mates who've been doing the work. Indeed, to some extent, the statistics are kiboshing the notion that Japan are faster and more mobile. The fastest three players in the Asian Cup out of these two teams so far are all Australians. Robbie Crew, Scott McDonald, Brett Holman. So the numbers are lining up for Australia. The second half has been kind to the Socceroos. They've looked dangerous. Japan rattled. But they're too good to write off the Samurai Blue.
We've played nearly an hour in this final. Despite Australia's chances, they've not yet been able to breach Eiji Kawashima's goal. Even though they thought they had for a brief moment. It's a mishit cross from Luke Wiltshire. Kale and Kuehl, the dual-pronged strike threat for the green and gold. Carney. To Ognanovsky, Wiltshire, Kuehl. He did well to dig it out, but he's given it straight to Sebe. Crowd lifts, at least the Japanese fans in there. Hugs up here for Maeda. And Yedinak helps out. Australia survive a little mini scare there. Back comes Japan through Hasebe. It's a bit of a clumsy one from Cahill.
More stunning recovery work from Mile Jedinek. Australia with good numbers. That ball could have bounced anywhere in truth. Mile Jedinek left his head.
Oh, an early shot taken by Keisuke Honda. Trying to catch Mark Schwartz unawares. Got to be good to do that.
Indeed. And this score from Japan has been a breather as much as anything. They've been under pressure. Excellent job forcing Japan back.
Can they find the breakthrough? Yedinak hangs another one up. Brought down beautifully by Cahill. Turns, tries to get it in towards Kuehl near post. And that's good goalkeeping by Kawashima.
And the quick release from Kawashima. Let's see how much spring there is in the legs of Japan, led by Yasuhito Endo now.
Nagatomo. The tempo starting to quicken in the Asian Cup final. Endo, Nagatomo, quick feet, heads off in a central direction, picks out a teammate, Okazaki, it's blocked, it falls for Maeda, narrow angle, and it's a goal kick, Australia defending well.
Just slipped when he needed to keep his feet, Okazaki just jinking and letting go, David Carney desperate, Maeda slipping at the crucial moment, Schwartz are untested. A good punch from Australia and a good counter punch from Japan. The game very much alive.
You can hear the Japanese fans in the background. They've been relatively quiet this evening. Trying to set something up for the Samurai Blue again. It's a beautifully weighted ball. Here they come, Japan. Endo. Honda. Okazaki. Give and go from Uchida. And a foul by Carney. Australia don't agree. The linesman's flag was up immediately.
decision from the assistant. This is a dangerous position for Australia. Good opportunity for Japan. Australia getting ready to make their first substitution. Brett Emerton is the man. I'll wait for this free kick to be taken, one would imagine.
So Mark Schwarzer, who's had a pretty quiet night thus far. Maybe about to be asked to earn his call. Endo to deliver.
Good. Good.
Yedinak meets it on the full. And it comes again towards Maeda. Kale is there for Australia. Only as far as Endo. Good pressure this by Alberto Zaccaroni's side. Nagatomo. A poor ball by Nagatomo, and subsequently by Jedinak. Maybe the tension's getting to the players as well. Out of play. And here's the change for Australia. Brett Holman is going to be the man to be replaced.
He's been struggling, Brett Holman, as much tonight, but over the course of the games.
So the 83rd cap for Brett Emerton. Of course, suspended for the quarterfinal against Iraq, and he's unable to get his place back either for the semi or for this final, but he's on now.
As well as Brett Holman's been doing, and he has been really good, there was a lot of murmuring around the Japanese press corps and television crews before the game, desperate to know if Emerton was going to play. Very nervous about Brett Emerton.
Well, he's playing now, as is Nagatomo. He's on the ball for Japan. Whips it on! Oh, it's just wide by Okazaki. A good chance for Japan. Perhaps their best of the night.
Close to the best chance for both teams of the night. Nagatomo twisting, turning into the crossing zone. He's a wonderful player. And now that he's been released into that left-wing position, Australia can expect more of this. But Shinji Okazaki should have done better. He lost David Carney, peeled off the flat line. Couldn't angle his header the way he needed. It's the best side of goal Japan have probably had.
Well, Schwarzer was beaten, no question about that. If Okazaki gets it on target, he scores. Japan's have had 7 shots on target, and of course, not one of them. Australia 10. Emerton getting involved. Australia just perhaps for the first time, Andy, looking a little uncomfortable.
Well, Japan have come into it well. The catalyst for it. And it's all about mentality. When you think back to that beautiful piece of control from Tim Cale down to the byline, squared it to the near post. Kawashima smothers it, leaps to his feet and launches a counter-attack. And that flick, that flick of the switch mentally for Japan has taken their game to another level. And on those sorts of moments, football matches can change. And it's a mental thing completely. Australia had Japan pushed down. Japan had run out of ideas. They'd lost their momentum. They weren't in their normal swagger. But their goalkeeper picks up that effort from Tim Cale. Away they go, and they've been a different team for the last 5 minutes.
Cale leaping along with Iwamasu, your right, Andy. Pretty sure that's his instructions after coming off the bench. Don't let Tim Cale win those aerial battles. Or at least not all of them. Emerton. Mackay. Carney. Again, they go aerially, Australia. Brookshire has dropped to the turf, claiming he got a whack in the head, back in by Jedinak. Tim Cale was lurking.
This has been a Herculean performance from Ilai Jedinak. He's everywhere. Won that last challenge to launch the ball into Japan's penalty area for a repeat attack.
Yoshida, a bit of a scruffy clearance, but it's found its way through to Maeda. Now here comes Japan. Through Uchida. There's a foul in there by the Japanese striker, and the roar will stay in the throats of the Japanese supporters at least for a little while longer.
Well, the game really is swinging beautifully. There's Jedinak again, right in the lap of his skipper in the heart of Australia's defence, dropping down from that midfield position. It's a good decision from the ref, either being overly boisterous.
But it's worked from box to box, Andy. Willie Jedinak has been outstanding. Roberto Zaccheroni controlling the technical zone. Such tension inside the Khalifa Stadium. Jedinak, it's too far for Matt Mackay. Goal kick. Olberosic urging a little bit more effort. You sense we're perhaps at a key moment of the football game. 20 minutes to go. Australia 0, Japan 0. Which side will blink first? Some of these super slow-mo pictures. Absolutely terrific. Hope you're enjoying them at home. Worldwide audience of over 100 million. Mexican wave going around the Khalifa Stadium. Kuhl unable to release Mackay.
Mackay just having a word to Shinji Okazaki for the manner in which he collapsed. The referee didn't appreciate it either.
Good flick on by Okazaki, but Okunovsky has kept a tight rein for the main part on Ryuichi Maeda. So the Cahill, but Kuhl is in behind. Is this the moment for Australia? Harry Kuhl! And Carl Schumer makes a terrific save to keep the score sheet blank. Well, he could have had a hat-trick tonight, Harry Kuhl.
And that was the clearest of his chances. He rode this beautifully. Fantastic touch to get rid of Iwamasa. And the keeper held his feet, then used his feet. Outstanding work. Eiji Kawashima, but Australia should have broken the deadlock at that point.
Emerton is a bit late with that lunge on Nagatomo. Well, what a chance for Harry Kuhl. Will Australia rue those missed opportunities? Here's Nagatomo sliding it in. Again, Ognanovsky, who's had a very steady game, gets there ahead of Maeda. And Emerton is away down the right. Japan throw in, though. Maybe a foul throw in. Well, Holger Osik must have thought that this was the moment, but that outstretched boot from Eiji Kawashima denying Harry Kuhl. Well, both teams now, Andy, have had a really good sight of goal. Okazaki at one end, Kuhl at the other.
Well, I thought Okazaki's was the best chance we'd seen. It was certainly the best crafted opportunity with a good finishing chance. But that Harry Kuhl moment has surpassed that. It was the chance of the match. Against Iraq, that left foot of Harry Kuhl's lobbed the goalkeeper, then the crossbar. Most people expected the reliable left foot of Harry Kuhl to do the business. Fast forward to final night, Harry Kuhl, different circumstances, different situation on the field, but similar scenario, 1v1 with the goalkeeper, and again, most people who've been watching Kiel for this last 15 years of football would have put most things they had on that left foot delivering. Outsmarted by Eiji Kawashima, excellent piece of work by Japan's goalkeeper.
He's had a few question marks placed against him, hasn't he, at this tournament, Kawashima, but certainly answer his critics there. That's well robbed by Mackay. Now Cahill hits the path of Harry Kiel. He just couldn't control it. It was coming at him at a fair old whack, in fairness. And Iwamasa concedes the corner.
I tell you, the change from Zaccaroni. Iwamasa, look how far forward he'd pushed. And it's too early to go from a central defender when your team's in possession. There's a quick changeover, he's out of position. And just the pass from Australia not sticking. Iwamasa played out of the game. Another good chance for Australia. Corner will have to do.
Hey, on that!
Which Luke Wiltshire is preparing to take.
Yeah!
Obnanowski leaps, it's away on the volley by Everton. Always rising.
They're worth a go though for Brett Everton. If he could manage to keep the ball down, which he can't, evidently, but if he could have kept the ball down, plenty of bodies to negotiate a ricochet. Shima's view would have been blocked.
There he is, Carl Valeri, again. He's pretty much covered every blade of grass on behalf of the green and gold this evening. Eiji Kawashima, a hero in Japan, no doubt, at this very moment. Thousands watching in the cities Japan, and I know there are live sites set up right around Australia as well, all the major towns and cities, the wee small hours down under, glued to a riveting Asian Cup final. Maeda, that'll be a corner for Japan.
One thing that substitution does give for Japan, however, is a chance for Shinji Okazaki to go back out on the right side and square up against David Carney. Chance denied him because of the way Zaccaroni picked the first 11 this evening. Fujimoto relegated to the subs bench again. Okazaki back on the right, and they're looking far more potent down that part of the field.
We're into the final quarter of an hour at the Khalifa Stadium. Japan have a corner, which Keisuke Honda will take.
Go
for the short routine. Hasebe. That was nicely teed up. Perhaps a training ground move there. That's the execution way, way off by the Japanese skipper.
Indeed, enough pressure put on by Brett Emerton, and a quick goal kick taken now by Mark Schwarzer. Wonderful flow. We consider it's a final being played. How often, Simon, how many finals have we watched where it turns into a stalemate, a game of chess? People too nervous, so they don't take any chances. Well, both teams here having a real crack.
Kieran has released Brett Everton. Cahill waits in the centre, and he just can't get enough contact. And again, Kawashima snaffles the ball.
Australia just running out of bodies in this moment. Beautiful pass, Harry Kiel. Keisuke Honda-esque. And it's 4 versus 1. Cahill into the near post. Title to go for the rebound, there's nothing more in it.
Hasebe slides it out wide right. Richard has delivery, that's Schwartz's. Hasn't been called upon too often this evening, Mark Schwartzer.
It's an easy one for Schwartz to turn up. It's a good cross from Suto Richard. Again, it's the right-hand side of Japan, which is starting to fire.
Now, flags raised near touchline, presumably for offside against Cahill, or maybe a foul. Just bisecting the two Japanese players. Oh, of course, did go to extra time there at semi-final. Slightly more tired legs than Australia, who had much easier hit-outs here at the Khalifa Stadium against Uzbekistan in their semi. We're talking about fine margins. And this is Neil. Carney looking for Harry Kuehl. On top for Kale, who then was a little late on Iwamasa. Free kick. Well, I think it was just actually his forward momentum that took him into Tim Kale. But
yeah, it was a free kick, but nothing more. Good game, sweeping so far, the referee. Expect as much, the number one in Asia.
Rosic just making a point to Brett Everton. Maybe a slight tactical tweak. Neil. Under pressure from Nagatomo. Play on, even though there's a push on Yedinak there. Advantage played by Afshan Ermatov. Neil. Kuehl. It's what Harry Kuehl has done so well at this tournament. The ball comes to him. Even in tight spaces, it sticks. Mackay, too deep for Cahill. Ten minutes to go. Extra time starting to loom large. Two very evenly matched sides. Both have had their opportunities. Haseda. Honda. Gets away from Ognjanovski. Lovely ball by Honda. Maeda forced a little wide though. Held up by Neil. And cleared by Wiltshire. But again, the vision of Keisuke Honda is a joy to watch at times.
Something else. It's surgical precision. Look at that. He's threaded the needle with that pass. Australia regroup. Kept their composure well. Could have turned out much nastier than it did for the Socceroos.
Will switch it. Iwamasa. Uchida, nowhere to go. Back some 60 metres to his goalkeeper. Endo. Kono to Nagatomo. Of Mila Jedinak. Just overran it there, Keisuke Honda. Now it's with Brett Everton for Australia. And they look for Kale, that should be the goalkeeper's, and is.
I thought it was probably worth Brett Everton putting the ball down the flank and putting Kono under some pressure as left fullback transplanted, left fullback.
Maeda. Man over on the right is Uchida. Three away for the delivery. Carney gives away the corner kick.
Defended David Carney.
Their focus. They'll probably fully aware that there's only 7 minutes to go. A goal here could be fatal. Brett Emerton got that a bit wrong, didn't he? But no harm done.
Looked like he was about to do the work.
He just sort of flopped on it.
Ball must have dipped on him. It's a second effort coming for Japan.
Again for the boot of Yasuhito Endo. Delary watched it all the way. More importantly, watched Okazaki all the way. Tracked the run superbly. Now a free kick. The holding on Kuehl. Wiltshire. Cahill arriving. It's a good header one by Uchida. Kai happy to accept the throw in. Carney. It's becoming a bit of a predictable tactic by Australia. Just hang it up and hope for Cahill or Kuehl to get on the end of it.
Well, Japan have stabilised. Certainly helping their cause because they were rocking. Australia just need to get a little bit more variety back into their attack. I thought it was one of the real strong points in the first half of the Socceroos. That last possession from Brett Emerton I thought was instructive. I think as much as anything, keeping the ball in a dribbling situation down the flank at least sucks Japan's players back into their own territory. Australia have to get control of more of the football.
Well, Kuehl's done it well for them there. Square by Valeri to Mackay. Cahill will work it out to the left and David Carney. But again, they look for that diagonal delivery from deep. Cahill was offside, so he walks back. Well, I don't think Brett Emerton could have been offside. Or could he? Well, maybe the linesman thought he was interfering with play, Cahill.
Has well, to have been the decision.
No,
he was
right.
Offside.
Fair play.
It's not against Tim Cahill, it is against Brett Emerton.
Keep your focus, says Alberto Zaccheroni. Only the fourth offside decision of the match. Ogmanowski's gone down with a knock. That's a problem for Australia because Maeda is going through the middle here. Neil can't hold him up. Still Maeda. Ogmanowski's back at his feet now. And Carney makes the block with the shins. Sometimes those fine margins can decide football games. Ogmanowski injured and disorientated. Now Harry Kuehl, can he get there ahead of the goalkeeper? And yet again, he is denied by Kawashima.
Really good. That was excellent anticipation from Harry Kuehl. But just that moment from Connor as a left fullback. It's amazing how your mind becomes disheveled because you move into a foreign position. And as a, playing as a midfielder, as a central defender, I don't reckon Connor would have made that error from which Harry Kuehl looked to profit. I think Japan's left fullback position, Australia down their right, is emerging as a real opportunity for the Socceroos. Again, the goalkeeper, quick and committed.
Three minutes to go. How's your nerves at home? Wiltshire. Sasha Ogmanowski. Flicked on by Emerton. Intelligently too. Gets a return ball from Cahill. Emerton just couldn't gather the ball in his stride and Yoshida. Time to recover, puts it behind.
Of course, the advantage of the directness of Australia's play is that when it drops for them, Japan have barely any time to react.
Two minutes to go. Wiltshire has the corner for the Socceroos. No foul in there. Even though Cahill protests. Maybe there was a slight body check. Here comes a throw in. It's hoisted up towards Emerton. Carney and it's behind for a corner. Well done, Atsuto Uchida for Japan. But it sat so invitingly for David Carney. And that was heading goalwards.
I think it was Makoto Hasebe. It was the captain again in his team's moment of need. That sat beautifully for Carney. Well set up by Brett Hamilton after Sasha Okunovsky had had the wherewithal to hook the ball back into the danger zone. Japan rocking just slightly.
Carney to deliver from the other side. Cahill leaps and it comes here for Everton. Now Valeri. Wiltshire. Real up and under. Cahill jumps and again it'll be an Australian throw in. Good pressure by the Socceroos in the closing moments of this Asian Cup final. They find the spark that would surely win this Asian Cup at this late stage. Or will we head into extra time and then maybe even penalties? ...20 seconds of normal time to go. Japan pinned back. Wiltshire. Mackay. Carney had that glorious chance. Seconds ago, hung up by Jedinak. Kuhl can't win the aerial battle. Now a free kick for Japan and the pressure on them is alleviated. 2 minutes of added time to be played. How's your nerves, Andy Harper?
Well, they're holding up. I was a little nervous before kickoff, actually. It's been a great game. Thoroughly enjoyed it. We're going to have to sit through an extra time period, it seems. Both teams have really asked some serious questions of each other. Japan haven't been allowed to play the game consistently that they've wanted to play, and that's credit Australia for that. And Australia haven't been able to turn it into their own football match either.
It's the one last chance here for the Samurai Blue. No, says David Carney.
They have been running into their own cul-de-sacs as late of late, Simon. You called it well.
Larry, Kai, breaks here though for Nagatomo.
Their attack in the closing stages of the 90 minutes has lost the variety it had up until that point. Japan, they've buckled and they've been under pressure, but they've stood tall. And still, it's just that outstanding chance for Harry Kuehl remains. Of scrambled efforts otherwise. The other end of the field, Shinji Okazaki with Japan's best chance with that header just wide. Another tunnel cross.
Now Maeda. 20 seconds to go. They floated up looking for Okazaki and Lucas Mill was there winning a very important header. And it comes though for Case Bay Honda. Could be the last chance of the game. Schwarzer gets a good fist to the ball. And it comes for Endo. The 2 minutes of added time are up now. And Rafshan Ermatov blows for full time. They're going to have an extra half an hour in the Asian Cup final. They can't be separated after 90 minutes. It's Australia nil, Japan nil. And we're heading into extra time in Doha. Well, Andy Harper, what a contest it's been. What an arm wrestle it's been.
It's turned into an arm wrestle. And both teams have been able to file down the edge of each other's advantage. And it's a matter now of who recovers best. Now, Holger Osik in the Australian camp will be looking to reinforce the outstanding defensive work. Really, as a collective, they've defended beautifully. The structure's impeccable. The communication and the decision-making hasn't missed a beat. But he's going to need to inspire more variety in the final third again. It's playing into Japan's hands. And Japan, for their part, Zaccheroni, a couple of creaking moments, but real encouragement from the work of Shinji Okazaki and Uchida down the right-hand side. Nagatomo will stay a threat down the left-hand side, and Keisuke Honda remains into extra time, as he was at the start, the danger man.
it's a wonderful sight, the Khalifa Stadium. On such a big occasion, a capacity crowd. We've been treated to a fascinating contest. We'd say that on balance, Andy, that Australia have created a better chance. It's Harry Kewell. Might have had a hat-trick on another night.
Yeah, look, I don't think Japan really could have complained if Australia had settled this in normal time. And it's not as though they dominated the football match, but they certainly dominated the goal-scoring chances. Japan had a couple of great moments themselves. This was potentially controversial, but in the end, the referee and his assistants made completely the correct decision. And a very, very nervous moment there for Japan. That cross that went wrong from Luke Wiltshire, who's been outstanding for Australia. Needs to cross the line, the whole of the ball must cross the whole of the line, and it didn't go close. And Nagatomo only had brief moments. This was the best, and this is why he's so dangerous. Okazaki too. Kani had lost his man. That was the most dangerous moment, really, for Australia. Japan came in fits and starts from that point on, but on their flanks, Australia had defended well. The edge of the penalty area, they defended really well. This was expert set-up play from Harry Kewell. Keeper pumps the air with his clenched fist because he saved his team. That was the moment that could have won, should have won Australia the match in hindsight. Although, we're not to know how that would have changed Japan's approach if Harry Kewell had scored then.
Well, the score sheet remains blank after 90 minutes. The Crown Prince of Qatar enjoying the game and enjoying a joke with Michel Platini, the president of UEFA. Sepp Blatter, the FIFA president, is here too. And the two coaches, well, this is where they their call, Andy. And I think you can get by that little inference of Alberto Zaccheroni that he knows where the threats from Australia is coming. Watch out for the aerial prowess of Messrs. Kewell and Cahill. There's Gillis, the Australian physio, just working a bit of energy back into the tired legs of Tim Cahill.
A fair bit of tape on that left knee with Tim Cahill as well.
Well, he's been patched up to play on quite a few occasions at this Asian Cup. Suffering from a few bumps and bruises, the Japanese hover. They still believe they can be Asian champions for a fourth time, and why not? They've perhaps been second best in quite a few areas today, Japan. But as we've seen throughout this Asian Cup, on quite a few occasions, they have found a way not to lose. They're a good side, as are Australia. So, two 15-minute periods. Half an hour's extra time to be played, and if they still can't be separated, then we'll have penalty kicks. The Asian Cup final has only ever gone to penalties on two previous occasions, 1988 and 1996, both occasions won by Saudi Arabia. It's a dramatic but not a particularly satisfying way to decide a final. Needs must, and that's what will happen. Well, I think this is about the fifth huddle of the day from Japan.
It's become de rigueur, hasn't it? The team huddle, pre-kickoff. Australia with the kickoff. They put Japan under immediate pressure start of the second half when they had a kickoff. Let's see if they do the same. To Lucas Neal for the bomb into the box.
Ball is with Lucas Neal. Let's see what he does. Goes down the line instead, and Emerson was on his heels. Honda picks it up in midfield. Endo forward down the line, but a little too heavy for Nagatomo. Push forward into a much more advanced role since the arrival of Daiki Iwamasa. Kono shifting over to left fullback. Yoshida wins that one. Jedinak helps it back, and Ognjanovski beckons Schwarzer to come and gather. Everton's header. Kewell. Everton not quite on the same wavelength. Breaks kindly for the Blackburn Rovers flyer though. And he'll deliver it towards Cahill. Iwamasa there. Picked up by Kewell. Now for Larry. Looking for an option wide left. And that's David Carney. It's an awkward one for the Japanese defence. And they still haven't quite dealt with it. And eventually it's Kono who puts it behind. But it took them three or four goes to get that out of harm's way, Andy Harper.
Amazing panicking from Japan. It's a beautiful cross from David Carney. He's got a very, very sweet left foot. And he called it into being there. Interesting start for Australia. Very interesting start to the second half. Well, the first half of extra time.
Wilkes' delivery. Looks as though for a second it was going to drop for Neil. Will bounce here for Carney. Little drop of the shoulder. It goes. Well, they're not dealing with those crosses very well, Japan, but they've survived.
Look how they break now. Keisuke Honda over halfway. He'll be the intended recipient. Lucas Neil. Expert work.
And then he's tripped by Uchida.
So what's caught the eye at the start of extra time, Simon, is twice now when Australia have secured possession. They've looked to go down the right flank against Yasuyuki Kono, the transplanted left fullback. And I wonder if Holger Osik is going to ask his team to pressurise that part of the field. It did seem as though that might be an advantage that was looming. Their first two possessions in extra time. They've looked to get deep down the right, their right-hand side, Australia. Richard just winded.
And Australia back in possession through Sasha Ognjanovski here. Jedinak trying to push it into the path of Cahill. Asebe instead for Japan. Okazaki. And Maeda not quite on the same wavelength. Endo's touch, Asebe, that's a good ball. Now Nagatomo, with a chance perhaps to run at Wiltshire. Then he checks onto the right boot. Kono. Endo. Nagatomo, try and get beyond Wiltshire again, which he's been unable to do for most of this game. Maeda. And the route to goal just blocked off. The first opportunity by Australia. Still Japan have it though. Kono.
Well, it's a very impressive wall built by Holger Osik. Really, really impressive. They've defended with such coordination. They've really put Japan back on their heels. They normally attack with such elan. Samurai Blue, but they're having to second guess their options because every time they get their head up, there's another Australian closing them down. And when they switch the play, it's like a swarm of yellow shirts switching the play with the Japan attack. Part of the game has been outstanding for Australia.
Minutes played, first period of extra time. Still Australia nil, Japan nil. Kono looking for the run of Maeda, but it's not the sort of ball you want played when you enter extra time, is it really? And you've run your socks off. Japanese fans, always colourful, always noisy, always enjoying themselves. Carney and Mackay play between them, getting the throw in for Socceroos. Perhaps understandable that it was going to be so tight between these two. They've met on 18 previous occasions. Australia just about had the edge with 7 wins. 6 draws as Emerton charges towards the ball, but Kawashima has been very safe and secure so far tonight.
That's a very tasty option for Mille, isn't it? Just a stab outside of the foot pass. She was up to it. Space opening up now for Keisuke Honda.
Nagatomo, but across comes Wiltshire. That's a super tackle.
He's been outstanding tonight. Hasn't had a great tournament till this point, but he's back to his very best, Luke Wiltshire. His team needs him to be.
And of course, back in tandem with his regular right flank partner, Brett Emerton, such a feature of Australian sides in recent seasons. Looks as though Japan, Andy, are contemplating a change. Tadanaki Lee, the striker with Korean heritage, is stripped and ready. Meantime, this is Uchida. Endo. Seibe's ball. Uchida. Off the shins of Carney. Corner for Japan. Here's the change.
Ichi Maeda to make way. Tadanari Lee make his grand entrance.
Well, that's just his second cap. The striker from Sanfrecce Hiroshima.
He had that golden chance at 1-1 game one against Jordan. Japan had come back to win it 2-1. He stumbled over the ball on or about the penalty spot. Jordan survived. And Australia have the same fortune.
Andrew's ball in, and Yedinak just takes it away. From the onrushing Japanese attacker, who was Daiki Iwamasa. Japan having a little spell here. That's a good ball into the box. Here's the substitute, Tadanari Lee. Slips it through for Uchida. And Yedinak is there again.
Lucas Newell appealing for handball, I think, when the ball first went through. Maybe for holding the shirt, definitely for the handball. I wouldn't have given that. It can't be intentional. It can't be deemed intentional, which it must. But again, underlining Australia's commitment to the cause. There were plenty of numbers there to cover.
Watch it up. Quickly closed down by Mackay. Australia just sleeping for a moment. Again, Yedinak is there. He's been everywhere tonight, in truth. This is Kale, who's reappeared for extra time with a little more strapping to that left knee. Now Brett Emerton. Cahill. Valeri. Emerton. Trying to steer it into the path of Kuehl. No joy for Australia in terms of trying to get past Kawashima. 5 minutes to go, first period of extra time. Chida. Endo almost sneaked it through Ognjanovski, but not quite. Emerton. Caught on the blind side by Kono. Hasebe. Well, no foul by Mackay. Australia can continue through Brett Emerton. Makes a beeline for Mackay on the left flank. Cahill and Kuehl wait for the delivery. Cahill leaps. That's rather leaped into Eiji Kawashima, who is a little bit displeased.
Looked like he was trying to pull Tim Cahill's arm out by the socket there. Timmy Cahill's left arm did hurt. There's no question about that. It is a correctly adjudged foul. He's entitled to go for the ball there. However, goalkeepers do tend to get very precious. Good work from Matt Mackay to win the possession and then set the crossing situation up. Robbie Cruz is with the fourth official. Well, that had been Tim Cahill's last contribution.
We'll find out in a moment or two. Everton. Jedinak. Mackay through the centre. And you get it into the path of Kuhl. Here is Kuhl. Everton! Another chance for Australia. He just tried to lift it over the top of Kawashima, but couldn't steer it into the back of the nets.
It's to be Harry Kuehl's last contribution. It's the right option from Everton. Within his rights, really, to have done better from there. The goal at his mercy. Kuehl battling away to form the chance. Brett Everton knows as soon as it's left his boot that he's hit it wide. His teammates on the bench weren't privy to the same angle, of course. Now Robbie Cruz. Will the Cruz factor, the speed factor of Robbie Cruz, tip this one the way of Australia? He is, according to that which we've been provided, quite clearly the fastest man on the field. A tiring, sluggish defence for Japan could get sprung.
What a moment for the Melbourne Victory youngster. On for just his fourth cap. Of course, replace the injured Josh Kennedy, who plays his football in Japan. Might be some irony there if Cruz was to come off the bench and score the winner. Mackay looking for Everton. It breaks kindly for Blackburn Rovers man. Cure, or rather Cruz, and it's saved by Kawashima. Again, he's the hero for Japan. Just stuck out a big right paw, Eiji Kawashima. And Robbie Cruz, what an introduction that would have been.
The work to do now for Australia defensively.
Honda, oh, just wide. Chances at both ends in the space of a few seconds, and neither taken.
Well, brilliant sweeping football, both teams. Matt Mackay setting up Australia's chance for Robbie Cruz, brilliantly saved, and Honda with the crowd pleaser. That's a delightful cross from Brett Emerton. Cruz having to stop his run. He makes great contact. It's a good header. And just even a fraction of a yard further to the right of Eiji Kawashima and Australia would have been to the good. But it's great work from Japan's custodian.
Valeri wins the ball. Cruz wins a corner. And he almost won the hearts of every single Australian. There's Cooper, the final action of the first period of extra time. Still, we're deadlocked at 0-0. Boy, both sides have been close in the last couple of minutes. Here's the corner from Everton. Mackay drills it. Just over the top. It won't go in for either side.
Well, it's not their best chance, but it has to go down as another good one. Matt Mackay, if he only hit the one at the start of the match with such conviction. Extra time might have been needed, but he's emerged as the game has gone on. Mackay, it's been another very impressive game. And that slow-mo, it's brilliant television.
And it shows you just how close it was. 1 minute of added time at the end of the first period. And here's Cruz. Good strength by the Melbourne Victory striker, and he can't release Carney. A break here for Valeri. Wiltshire. looking for the angle for the cross. Emerton will provide it, and it's too deep.
Emerton picked Robbie Cruz's starting position. Didn't anticipate the run of Cruz. Half time, extra time. Nothing settled yet. The game just gets more and more fascinating.
Still, we await the breakthrough. Australia nil, Japan nil. Well, Robbie Cruz has had an opportunity. Keisuke Honda had a good one at the other end too. Who has got the mental strength to see it through? Penalty kicks just 15 minutes away. Australia, of course, have Mark Schwarzer, who has a decent bit of form in penalty shootouts, Andy. Mind you, the way Kawashima has been playing tonight, he might back the Japanese goalkeeper.
Well, don't even count as that scenario at the moment, Simon, if you wouldn't mind. I think both teams deserve to have a winner in normal football. As painful as that might be or will be for the loser, if there's to be one. At the end of extra time, 15 minutes to play before that penalty shootout situation, Australia continue to rack up the chances and they continue to be profligate. Japan's goalkeeper, Eiji Kawashima, has had a fair bit to do with that. He's had a great game.
Well, they might still be level on the score sheet, but we are heading towards the end game. 15 minutes left. And then the dreaded spot kick shootout. Now Nagatomo skips away from Wiltshire. Cannons back off the back of Lucas Neal, and Ognjanovski paired out to make the challenge. It was a good decision by big Sasha Ognjanovski. Timed it to perfection. And this is Matt Mackay. Cahill. Kai slips it through. Cahill, chance to shoot. Very quickly closed down though by Connor. Good defending.
Again, good short game from Australia. Matt Mackay in the middle of it. Well, perhaps just delayed a little bit too long. The shot is still hobbling around some car. Left knee is causing some trouble.
That's a good one too. Honda's vision again. Releasing Okazaki, at least for the moment. Uchida arriving. Ognjanovski in the way again. Saving. Keisuke Honda looking to just drop the shoulder, and he does. Gets rid of Valeri. Can't find the delivery, but he gets the corner kick.
And again, he didn't quite get rid of Carl Valeri, and that's been one of the keys to Australia's performance. He hung on like a drover's dog, did Carl Valeri, and David Carney comes to his assistance. Not even the great Keisuke Honda can beat the two Australian defenders. The corner will have to do for Japan.
Which Endo is about to deliver. Neal couldn't get there. Brett Emerton nods it back out towards Endo. Left-footed delivery this time. Schwarzer misses it, and it'll be a corner, although Australia are claiming the foul on the goalkeeper.
I don't think that's a fair play. It is inside the six-yard box, and often goalkeepers get the call there, but I think that's a fair play. Schwarzer came, he was strong, Yashida was strong, it was a strong contest. Now Australia with all the work to do defensively.
Australia going to make another change shortly. Meantime, here's Endo. It's rather more comfortable for Mark Schwarzer. Neil Kilkenny is going to be thrown on by Hogger Osikandi.
Well, I can only assume it's going to be for Tim Cahill, but that will leave Australia as a striker short. Unless one of the central midfielders has done enough for the day. It's been fantastic. Internet, Valeri.
Cahill trying to control it, and again he's angry that the referee hasn't blown up for what he perceives to be a foul. Instead, Japan are on the counter. through Nagatomo here on the left. Forced back by Neil.
Superb work, Lucas Neil.
Endo. Down the line for the dangerous Nagatomo again. He tries to get around. Wiltshire does. Is this the moment? It is! Japan scores! It's the captain. Japan lead in the Asia Cup final with 4 minutes of added time play in the second period of extra time, and it's the substitutes, Tadanari Lee, who has broken the deadlock finally. Heartache for Australia, joy for Japan. And it was Nagatomo with the killer delivery.
Well,
finally he got free.
Sorry, Simon, he was always going to be the danger man. That's a classy, classy finish. And there are enough Australians there, but one need to pull off and make sure that Tadanari Lee was marked. He wasn't. He finishes with amazing aplomb. It's a beautiful finish on the back of a beautiful cross from Yuto Nagatomo, one of the players of Asia Cup 2011. And Australia with 11 minutes to turn things around. Make that 10. Tim Cale has made way for Neil Kilkenny. Brett Emerton has gone to join Robbie Cruz in the twin strike force.
Well, what have Australia got left? It's a devastating blow. They've had so many chances, the greener goals, but now they're up against it. This team has character, we know that. But it's a hammer blow, Andy Harper.
No, it's just a beautiful finish. And there was never a secondary thought, I'm going to take a second touch and pull myself. He backed his technique. It was unfailing technique. Schwarzer with no chance. The post-mortem for Australia will be, how did he get so free? They've been so diligent. And they've had their chances. And now they must work for at least one more.
Japan, inspired by that goal, are going for the killer. Second, and they've got a free kick.
And Mackay's just losing his ball a little bit now. He's going to get a yellow card for that sarcastic outburst at the referee. It's the time for cool heads, not hot heads. The tackle that needed to be made. Okazaki was away. There's nothing wrong with the decision of Matt Mackay. It's a clear foul. KSK Honda will surely look to make it 2-0 Japan.
Well, they're in no hurry to take this. Why should they be? But two killer dead ball specialists standing over this free kick. If they score here, it's good night, Australia. It's Endo. And it's well claimed by Schwarzer. Australia still alive.
If anyone needs reminding, South Korea equalised their semi-final with Japan in the 120th minute.
Only the second goal Australia have conceded at this tournament. They've got to find one of their own at the other end, and quick, if they're to stay in contention. There's confirmation of the change by Holger Osik. Kilkenny on for Cahill. What a beautiful finish it was.
Delightful.
By Tadanari Lee.
Delightful. Schwarzer with no chance.
Michael!
Well, you can see the despair in Mark Schwarzer's eyes. He knows he's going to get nowhere near that.
And the troops head forward for the green and gold. This free kick to be taken by David Carney. right in front of the Australia supporters group, or the key bunch of them anyway. This is going to go right into the penalty area. A melee to result.
Carney's delivery, but it's too deep. Goal kick. More time ticks away. Japan edged closer to what would be a fourth Asian Cup. And the Kangaroos a little bit deflated at the moment.
Who's staying forward for the remaining parts of this game?
Understandably so. Valeri. Tired looking cross from Carl Valeri. They'll get a second go though, Australia. Matt McKay hangs it up. Emerton heads over the top. In fact, it came off a Japanese defender, so it's going to be a corner for Australia.
Well, how much pressure can Australia put on? How much physical pressure, how much aerial pressure can they put on with the time that's remaining? Every Japanese player is in the penalty area of Japan.
Wiltshire. Goalkeeper wasn't sure. And he touches on it. The second attempt and his big foul too by Yedinaka. Good header one by Ognanowski initially. Clear foul by Yedinaka. He was lucky to escape a yellow card for that, in truth. Here's another look at the goal and what a finish it was from Tadanari Lee. And that's what it means to the Japanese bench. Alberto Zaccheroni punches the air in delight. By contrast, heartache for Australia. Not yet out of this. 4 minutes to go. Kilkenny penalised.
The test for Japan is how well they can take the sting out of this game.
Endo trying to do just that. Prods it towards the corner.
Box Australia in now, deep in their own territory.
Neil half volleys it up towards Emerton. Here's Ognanowski, big physical presence. Now does it squirt into the path of Robbie Cruz? Very nearly. He allows the ball to go out because he knows Australia have a corner.
Sasha Ognanowski just bludgeoned his way through that challenge. Forced the opportunity that fell for Cruz, who decided I'll take the corner here. He'll hoof the ball into or around about the 6-yard box of Japan.
Can Wiltshire get the delivery right for Australia? Looks as though it's too close to the keeper. No foul though on Kawashima. Emerton returns it. Up goes Robbie Cruz. Here's Carl Valeri. Can't get a clean look at goal. Still Australia applying pressure. Wiltshire, Valeri. Oh, he was closed down there by Uchida.
It was tired too from Carl Valeri. He's run himself into the ground. After intense physical contest from those corners. Kawashima down again. Will require attention. Enormous number of bodies through which he has to get. Australia came again and Japan throwing their bodies at the shots, blocking everything. Of course, it'll be rifling through their memory, of course, the way they conceded their lead in the 120th minute of the semi-final.
Well, Holger Osik's sides have 2 minutes to save their Asian dreams. Otherwise, it will be Japan's name going on the trophy for the fourth time. Kilkenny spreads it wide. It's a good ball. high for Emerton. Carney's there to help too. Here is David Carney. Trying to dig it out under heavy pressure. Mackay. And they square it up for Kilkenny here. Carney onside. Lobs it up. But there he can't get there. Here's Luke Wiltshire. Desperate stuff here for Australia. Kilkenny with the shot. And he's pulled it wide. Might that be Australia's final opportunity?
They're not going to die wondering to stop the Roos. I mean, they're squeezing up the field. They're trying to work for this opportunity. Japan desperate as they need to be. It's a really outstanding scrambling. 118 minutes into a continental final, and Yuto Nagatomo is still sprinting from Australian to Australian, trying to pressurise the ball carrier, block the shot. Inspirational stuff from the Chisena man. You know how to come on. It's Butcher to come off for Japan, the final change. It's another central defender. Academic exercise, you'd imagine, but Alberto Zaccheroni is insisting on more aerial strength.
Well, also the chance to run down the clock by a few seconds as well. He's nearly there, Alberto Zaccheroni. About to lift a major trophy. He's only been in the job for 6 months. And they're within touching distance. The Blue Samurai. 15 minutes are up now. 1 minute of added time. It's now or never for Australia. Yeah, hey! Kilkenny. Can they fashion one final chance? The greater gold. Wiltshire hangs it up looking for Ognanowski. Carl Valeri looks very tired. Australia have a throw in. Wiltshire back to Valeri. Another throw in for Australia. Sands of time almost up on their Asian dreams in the desert. Kilkenny. Wiltshire, handball, free kick, right on the edge of the box for Australia. Well,
Matt Mackay appealing for a penalty. It wasn't a penalty, it's a definite handball. And this surely was Australia's last chance.
Now, who do you fancy from here, Andy? Sasha Ognanowski could blast it. David Carney could place it. Brett Emerton's a chance too.
Carney's looking to have the most nervous anticipation.
Can Australia save themselves with probably the final kick of this Asian Cup final? This has to be the final chance for the Socceroos. David Carney straight into the wall. Still it's alive. Kilkenny drives it across. Carney's header. Still alive. Australia trying to push it home. The final whistle goes. Japan are the champions of Asia. Fabulous score for the Blue Samurai. The undisputed kings of Asia move out on their own. And Australia's golden generation is denied silverware. It was not to be their finest hour, but it is Japan's. Australia nil, Japan on the scoreline after extra time. Tadanari Lee's goal wins the trophy for Japan. Joy unbridled for the Japanese, tears and heartache for Australia. But they had their chances, Andy Harper. On another night, they might have won comfortably.
Well, first things first, it's hard to deny Japan, who along with South Korea are leading the way on a whole range of fronts. Japan, in particular, out on their own as a football organisation, the amount they invest in development, the forward-looking nature of their organisation, the commitment to investment, fantastic. And who can deny them? Four times champions of Asia. Now they're out on their own, as you say, Simon. They are the undisputed kings of the Asian Football Confederation. and good luck to them because they deserve it. But on the balance of the no buts, this game was a great game of football. Australia had their chances, there's no doubt about that. And they'll rue those missed efforts. They could have beaten South Korea match day two, but for the same issue. They hit Uzbekistan for six in the semi-final, and I guess a number of people understand that they came into this game thinking that they'd found their scoring boots. Well, Japan defended better, obviously, much better than Uzbekistan did today. Still, Australia had their chances, but they couldn't finish off. And the key moment for Japan was beautifully finished by Tadanari, their beautiful cross Nagatomo. I find it hard to deny Japan, really. We just admire what they do so much. Australia were fantastic tonight, an excellent performance by the Socceroos. With more good stuff to come under this coach, you'd imagine. And they just fell on the wrong side of one chance that was expertly taken.
Well, little wonder that Alberto Zaccheroni went to embrace his goalkeeper. He was outstanding tonight, Eiji Kawashima, denying Australia on several occasions. The two coaches, the Italian and the German, sharing a handshake and an embrace. It wasn't a B for Holger Osik, looking to make it two continental titles after leading Canada to success 11 years ago. There's the match winner, Tadanari Lee. An inspired substitution, you could say, by Zaccheroni. And they claim the cup for the fourth time. And I suppose now for Australia, Andy, the question is, do some of the golden generation continue? Or is it time for regeneration? Probably too early for those questions, but
you've asked them anyway.
That will be the immediate thoughts, I'm sure, over the next few days.
Well, it's a case-by-case basis. No, I would ride them off as a collective, and certainly I'd work through the individuals, see how they're going. But my stand on this has remained consistent. I wouldn't be looking to move on any of the core senior players. I would be looking to bring youngsters in around them. I mean, what fantastic lessons to learn off Tim Cahill, Harry Gill, Lucas Neal, who again was fantastic in this tournament. What about the tournament of Matt McKay? What about the tournament of Sasha Okhanovsky? Fantastic. I mean, Okhanovsky, I know he's 31. He looks like he's been doing this for ages. His decision-making was expert. We know he's physical. We know he's good in the air. But his decision-making and the partnership with Lucas Neal, fantastic. So I can only see good things to come, so long as the infusion of new blood is done on a concerted and considered basis. But I wouldn't be writing any of these players off case by case. Individually, you work around and see how they're going, where they're at. And then experts have to make the decisions on how much more they reckon they can contribute. But on the evidence of Asia Cup 2011, this is a group primed to infuse new blood and teach the new blood with the experienced old hands. You're fantastic, really fantastic. What an outstanding quarterfinal display against Iraq. What an outstanding performance against South Korea. And my point on South Korea, the team that beat them would win the tournament. No one could beat South Korea. And Japan had to wait till deep into extra time to beat Australia. The best three teams in the region finished 1-2-3. I can't see it being any more fair than that.
D選手を入れることによって、前田選手のような空中戦の強い選手を一人外さなければいけなかったんですけども、やっぱりあそこはやってくれるだろうと信じて思い切ってピッチに送り込みました。La grande
forza di questa squadra è che chi entra dalla panchina poi va in campo e fa la differenza.
ま、このチームの素晴らしいところはやっぱりベンチスタートした選手が結果を出してくれることこれだと思ってます。一言、日本のサポーターにメッセージをお願いします。メッセージは一方的。
Ma io credo che debbano essere solamente orgogliosi di avere una squadra così compatta che ha fatto di tutto per onorare il Giappone.
そうですね、日本の国民の皆さんもやっぱりこういった代表チームがいるということを誇りに持っていただきたいなと本当に素晴らしいチームです。ありがとうございます。このチームをまだ温かい目でずっと見守っていってくださいとお願いしたいです。
ありがとうございました。本当におめでとうございます。ザッケローニ監督でした。ありがとうございます。そして、リー・タダナリ選手です。今の気持ち聞かせてください。最高です。どうでした？いや、ずっと試合出れなかったんで、絶対チャンスをつかめると自分で信じて、待ち続けた結果、取れました。本当に嬉しいです。 あのピッチに入る前なんですけれども、延長を待っている間、あの控え選手たちがロッカーに行って水を持ってきましたよね。あの時の気持ちってのはどうだったんでしょう。
いや、もうずっと俺はヒーローになると自分に言い聞かせて、ピッチに入りました、はい。
日本アジアの頂点です。改めて今の気持ち聞かせてください。
いや、このピッチに立ってたことは本当に幸せです。本当にありがとうございます。
最後の一言、サポーターにメッセージをお願いします。
もうこれからも、アジアのチャンピオンとして、頑張っていきたいと思いますので、まあ、日本代表を、応援よろしくお願いします。
ありがとうございました。見事決勝ゴール、李忠成選手でした。
Well, there we go, the thoughts of Tadanari Lee. He's won the game for Japan. But Australia had their moments. Harry Kuehl in particular had two or three opportunities. But it just wasn't to be for Australia, appearing in their first Asian Cup final.
He's had it!
There's a big talking point here, but the correct decision was made, Andy Harper.
Yeah, no doubt. The ref didn't get much wrong tonight. He had a good game. I think, you know, two sets of players had good games. The ref had a good game. It was a final befitting the occasion, in my opinion. And I think probably the most poignant thing of all is the person awarded the man of the match, which was the goalkeeper for Japan, Eiji Kawashima. Sometimes we scratch our heads at those decisions, but not tonight. He was the difference between the teams. This was the moment that separated the teams on the scoreboard, but at that moment, it was a similar one, Nagatomo. That could have been Shinji Okazaki giving the lead. And it's Nagatomo who, in the lead-up to the game, in the opinion of many people, certainly in mine, that the match-deciding action was going to come down from that left-hand side. And it was a beautiful cross to win it. Now, this was Australia's best moment. The angle, not overly kind to Harry Kuehl, but still a very, very makeable chance. And Kawashima is in goal. And I thought he was poor in the quarter-final against Qatar. Came back from the suspension of match day three after being sent off against Syria, and has come straight back into the team. Here's the goalkeeper again, just with heroics. Now, it's a game of margin, Simon. So, you know, Robbie Cruz, if that header, I know it's if. If's a massive word in life, isn't it? It's only two letters. It just represents so much. But just a little, even a half yard to Kawashima's right, and Australia take the lead. I think this is probably the moment now. Nagatomo gets half a yard on Luke Wilshere. He's just a mile free in the box. Maybe David Carney has drifted where he needn't be. But, you know, that's just fish and chip paper now. It was a superb cross and a brilliant finish.
Sure was. Good enough to win the 2011 Asian Cup. Tadanari Lee, remember the name, just his second cap tonight. And he'll remember that one, well, for the rest of his days, I'm pretty sure. Super finish. A goal worthy of winning a trophy. And ultimately, it did. Taking the applause and their bows in front of the crowd. There's the trophy. They'll be lifting very shortly. The on-pitch stage has been assembled. We're just waiting for the dignitaries to arrive. And then the medals, or the miniature trophies as they are in the Asian Cup, will be dished out to the players, followed by the trophy itself. Well, there you go, Andy. 18 shots on target Australia had. They were unable to convert a single one of them. The possession stats pretty equal. But it just wasn't to be for the Socceroos, and Japan took the one chance that mattered through Tadanari Lee. 15 saves made by Eiji Kawashima. Thus a worthy recipient of the Man of the Match awards. He was terrific tonight. Japan maintain their excellent Asian Cup record. They've now lost just one of their last 24 Asian Cup finals matches. That was to Saudi Arabia in the semi-finals 4 years ago. They're a very, very tough side to beat, even when they're not playing well. And they've proved that at this tournament. For a presentation party to arrive. Japanese fans saying thank you to Qatar. And overall, Andy, it has been a good tournament, a well-organised tournament. There's been a couple of issues with crowds here and there, but overall we've seen some pretty good football and some great goals.
I think it's a football tournament. It's been great fun, which is exactly what you want. The top teams, as they're constituted at the moment, have rose to the top. I think the way the semi-finals and quarter-finals broke themselves up, one half of the draw was very, very difficult. The other opened up. Australia managed to survive its quarter-final with an easy semi-final. South Korea finishing second to Australia in that group had the much difficult, more difficult road home. But the good teams finished where they needed to. Iran, good team, beaten by South Korea, excellent team. And Japan rose to the very top, deservedly so, fantastic. And they beat a very, very gallant, and I think a very, very good Australia in this Asian Cup 2011. It's a good football tournament. Jordan, Syria won't ever forget their contribution. Big question marks asked of the big countries, China and Saudi Arabia. But the developed football cultures and the developed economies behind those cultures have won the day.
Completes a great 12 months for Japan. Of course, they got to the second round of the World Cup in South Africa last year. Now they're Asian champions again. It qualifies them automatically for the Confederations Cup in 2013. So they'll have three big tournaments in 3 years. The Confed Cup in 2013, World Cup 2014, and then they will defend the Asian Cup in Australia in 2015. Talking of 2015, you just saw a few seconds ago the official AFC flag being lowered in the stands here at Khalifa Stadium. That is so it can be officially handed over to Football Federation Australia Chairman Frank Lowy. That will take place very shortly. Meantime, the interminable wait for the VIPs goes on. Well, all the Japanese players want to do is get their hands on their trophies and the main cup itself. And finally, here they come, led by the AFC presidents, Mohammed bin Hammam. Well, there is the official handing over of the AFC flag from the Qatar FA via Mohammed bin Hammam to Mr. Frank Lowy, the chairman of Football Federation Australia. Of course, Australia, the next host of this tournament in 4 years' time. So they make their way off the pitch. The players will have to wait a bit longer to get their hands on the trophy because coming up next we have the top scorer awards, the Golden Boots for the 2011 Asian Cup, which is going to be presented, of course, to Ku Jia Chol. Gathered was a little promotional video of Australia 2015. So before the presentation of the trophy, we're going to have the top scorer award, as I was saying, presented to Ku Jia Chol of South Korea. Following that, it'll be the Fair Play Awards, then the Most Valuable Player Awards, the Referee Commemorative Awards, and then finally, we'll get onto the teams. So the four dignitaries on stage, Mohammed bin Hammam, the AFC President, His Royal Highness Prince Ali bin Hussein, the FIFA Vice President, newly elected, of course, from Jordan, Moya Dodds of Australia, the AFC Vice President, and His Highness Heir Apparent Sheikh Tamim bin Hamad Al Thani of Qatar. The Golden Boot Award. I'm pretty sure that's not Ku Jia Chol. It's obviously somebody accepting it on his behalf. Maybe it's his dad. Alberto Zaccheroni waits. He just wants to get his hands on that trophy and get off to celebrate with his team. There we go, a trophy and a check for $10,000 goes to Ku Jia Chol of South Korea. Thank you. Moya Dodd of Australia is going to present the next award, which is the AFC Fair Play Trophy. And the Fair Play Trophy is going to be presented to Japan. No, it's not, it's South Korea. Apologies, we're sort of doing this on the hoof. We don't know who's winning these particular awards, so bear with us. Player awards. And to present this trophy, it's His Highness Heir Apparent Sheikh Tamim bin Hamad Al Thani. At least we're in no doubt as to who's won this particular trophy. That is Keisuke Honda. And well deserved. Tournaments, Keisuke Honda. Well done, sir. Now it's the referee's turn, and there's two officials. Dignitary is departing the stage, so I have to confess I'm not quite sure who's going to present the officials and the teams with their honours. I don't think they know either. So Sheikh Tamim bin Hamad Al Thani accompanies Mohammed bin Hammam onto the stage once more, and we're set for the presentations of the mementos to the referees and the officials. Compatriots Rasilov Abdul Kamadulo and Rafael Ilyasov. And then finally, the teams will get their turn. Pretty long wait. I'm sure when you've just lost a major final, what you'd really like to do is get off the park. They've had to wait by my watch nearly half an hour. Lucas Neal leads his team forward to receive their runners-up trophies. And although they're disappointed today, they can be proud of their efforts at this Asian Cup. They've had a very good tournament.
Yeah, it's a sad night for them. They gave such good value. They will think they probably should have won this match. That'll be their immediate recollection of the final of the 2011 Asian Cup. That's a deep detail now. On balance, they were fantastic tonight. Beat by a team who, with real aplomb, took the chance that came their way. And Lucas Neal has led this team excellently. Mark Schwarzer marshalling the best defence in the competition. Carl Valeria, superb tournament. A lot of questions asked. What did Australia do when Jason Kalina wasn't available with his knee injury? Well, Yudinak and Valeria standing. Timmy Cahill hobbling through the ceremony again. Such an inspirational figure. Sash Ognjanovski, from nowhere to have an international career, and he never missed a beat. Fabulous work. Outstanding game tonight, Milo Jedinek. David Carney shook off the issue of that recurring dislocated shoulder to make his contribution. Robbie Cruz has burst onto the international scene now. A player whose career was at the crossroads at club level.
going nowhere fast at Brisbane Roar, and Melbourne Victory have revived his career. Credit to Ernie Merrick and the team at Melbourne Victory for the work they've done with Robbie Cruz, who's now a bona fide international option for the Socceroos.
Tommy Oru didn't play at this tournament. Late call-up for Richard Garcia, who was injured. John McCain, likewise. Nathan Coe, one of the reserve goalkeepers. Brad Jones, too. Neil Kilkenny, who came off the bench to good effect on several occasions.
Yeah, he's emerged as well. Really, a lot of his selection caught a lot of people by surprise. But Holger Osiek liked what he saw and used him judiciously off the bench. And again, he is emerging as another option in midfield. A very tidy player, very efficient user of the ball. But it is Japan's night. Fantastic the way they're leading Asia across a whole range of football fronts.
Goalkeeper coach is Tony Franken. The other backroom staff to follow.
Tell you what, if you don't hurry up, we'll be in Australia celebrating the 2015 Asian Cup.
I think everybody by the team cat has got one of those trophies, Andy. Anyway, finally we're ready. The victory days awaits for Japan. But of course, more specifically for the players. It's what you become a footballer for, Andy.
Well, it's all about winning trophies. That's why they sign up. And to do it for your national team, of course, the dream. At least, I'd imagine, half the 120 or so million Japanese who are part of this global community. They're very proud of their country, as they should be. It's not only the manner in which they've won their Asian Cup, it's the rapidity with which they've won it. They've got the foundation set. Set their 100-year vision, established the J-League in 1993. Get that going on a slow burner. Huge commercial success. And now it's a case of catch as if you can. I mean, they've won four of the last five Asian Cups, something like that. They've won four of the last six. And that's going to take some sort of effort to stop Japan. South Korea just behind them. They've really thrown down the gauntlet to Asia. It's brilliant to have this sort of leadership across a whole range of football fronts, and they're dominating on the field. The big mystery for Asia is how South Korea, as good as they are, haven't won this since 1960. That's now in the realm of the imponderable. I can't work that out. A super team. They've got to crack it for an Asian title sooner or later. And it brings it to sharp focus, Simon, Australia's situation. Second effort in the Asian Cup, that made the final, the second go. Temptation, I guess, from people who watch Australian sport to think this is going to be now a rite of passage to be here final day every 4 years. Well, you just look at the experience of South Korea to realise that's a fallacious notion. Japan are here and they've won it four times because they've organised themselves and they've worked for it. Canadian mind.
Yoshida getting his trophy. Late replacement at the start of the tournament, but didn't he do well? Nishikawa played his part as well, the reserve goalkeeper. Real team and indeed squad efforts by the Blue Samurai. Iwamasa did well off the bench today. Tim Cahill a little quieter than he was in the early stages of the final. And we shouldn't forget Shinji Kagawa and Daisuke Matsui as well. Two players who played big parts in the earlier part of the tournament, but had to go home through injury. Maeda going through, three goals at this tournament. And finally, the reserve goalkeeper, Shuichi Gonda. And Alberto Zaccaroni, the victorious coach. His first trophy since the Italian Serie A title with AC Milan back in 1999. Moment has finally arrived, nearly 45 minutes after we stopped playing, for Makoto Hasebe to make his way forward, the Japanese captain. He'll be presented with a trophy jointly by the Sheikh and the AFC president Mohammed bin Hammam, and Japan will be crowned. Japan, the champions of Asia for the fourth time. Congratulations to Japan, commiserations to Australia, our thanks to Qatar for putting on a great tournament. We'll see you in 4 years' time in Australia. From myself, Simon Hill, and from Andy Harper, it's good night from Doha.